Thank you, CFC family, for this opportunity to join you all. It's amazing that it's been 49 years and we've coming into our 50th year. I thought I would briefly share some of the things that the Lord reminded me of that I have learned from CFC that I haven't found in any other group of churches or teachings, and it has changed my life. If you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 13, Hebrews chapter 13. One of the first distinctive marks of CFC is that in this church, I heard people who could say, "Follow me as I follow Christ." I can honestly say I don't think I've heard a single other preacher say that. Follow me as I follow Christ. And yet, that's exactly what Paul said. And we read here in Hebrews 13, verse 7, remember those who led you, who spoke the word of God to you, and considering the result of their conduct, imitate their faith. Follow their faith. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1, follow me as I follow Christ. And here we see in Hebrews 13 what it is about Paul and Jesus also, ultimately. But even those who led us, who spoke the word of God to us, what is it about them that we can follow and should follow? It's not their preaching. It's not what jobs they had. It's not their way of speaking or copying them. It is their faith. And the faith, I'm very thankful, especially for my dad and mom, Brother Ian, and the example that my dad and Brother Ian have set for me personally and for us as a church is one that I believe will withstand, has withstood the test of time. But their faith, I thought I would start by looking at that. I think of three examples we have in the Old Testament, three examples of faith. Ultimately, Jesus is the author and perfecter and finisher of our faith. But I thought of three examples from the Old Testament that show us that I've seen that. An example in these godly brothers who have led us. And the first is Noah. If you turn back a few pages to Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews chapter 11, it says in verse 7, by faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household. By which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. I believe this is exactly what happened in 1975, that these brothers, being warned by God about things not yet seen, decided to prepare an ark, a local expression of the body of Christ, gathering in a little home, kicked out by the mainstream Christendom, not knowing what to do, as we already heard, but they decided to prepare an ark. And that's the ark that I believe the Lord is continuing to build today. We know the story of Noah. It saved his entire household, everything else was destroyed. And Noah continued to preach faithfully for many hundreds of years. Saying, get into the ark, get into the ark. He didn't change his message, even though nobody joined him. He didn't change his message. And ultimately, God validated his faith. And that's the faith I see in these godly brothers. The next example is in verse 26 is Moses, Hebrews 11, verse 26. Moses considered the reproach of Christ. Greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. And that too, I've seen in the example of these brothers in CFC. The reproach of Christ, the message of the cross and death to self, and the aspects of Christ that are not attractive, that was greater riches to these brothers who set the example for us than all the treasures of the rest of Christendom, because they were looking to the reward. And here we are reaping the reward of that today. The reproach of Christ. A lot of people in Christendom are drawn to the exciting things of Christ, the blessings of Christ, and all the other wonderful things that Christ can do for us. But what I heard here in CFC was that the reproach of Christ was far more valuable than any other of the treasures that the rest of Christendom are seeking, even the blessings. The reproach of Christ, and that's the example of faith I've seen here in CFC. The third example I thought of was Daniel. In Daniel chapter 1, Daniel, as you know, was unafraid to stand true to God, even though everybody else around him, all the other Jews around him, were compromising. And you've probably seen that play that we've seen in CFC, standing true to God in a day of compromise. I think that phrase describes CFC, standing true to God in a day of compromise. And here we read about Daniel in chapter 1, verse 8. Daniel set upon his heart, that's the literal translation there. Daniel made up his mind that he would not compromise. He would not defile himself, even though he was going to be the only one, even if he was the only one. And all the other Jews said, here we are in Babylon, let's fit in. We've got to win the Babylonians. Daniel said, no, I will not compromise. And as a result of that, three other brothers came alongside him and stood with him. And ultimately, Daniel got a revelation of the future kingdom of God that nobody else got, even in the Old Testament, because Daniel set upon his heart not to compromise. This is the example of faith that we have seen here, my dear brothers and sisters. Many of you, most of you, were not here when CFC started 50 years ago. But this is the example of faith that we have to this day. And praise God that he has preserved the life of especially these two brothers as living witnesses, as living examples of faith. So that's the first thing. Follow me as I follow Christ. And that is still the message I hear today. The second distinctive mark of CFC that I wanted to mention is that the opposite of God is money. The opposite of God is money. And I thought about this time, this period, if you turn with me to Joshua chapter 24, this period in time when Moses had died and now Joshua was getting to the end of his life, he had led God's people into the promised land, but the promise was not yet fulfilled. They were in the land of Canaan, in the land flowing with milk and honey, but they hadn't yet experienced the fulfillment of the promise that God would give them every piece of land on which their foot tread, and all the enemies would be defeated. And here you see an interesting sequence of events in Joshua 24, verse 19. It's a dialogue, it's a conversation between Joshua and the people of Israel. And Joshua keeps telling them, you better fear the Lord, you better reverence the Lord. And they say, yes, we will. And it goes back and forth. You can read it sometime, beginning in verse 14 onwards. But I just want you to see here in verse 19, then Joshua said to the people, this is Joshua 24, verse 19, you will not be able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. Joshua, on his deathbed, knew the condition of these people and said, you don't know God as a holy God. You won't be able to serve him. He is a jealous God. And look at what he says. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins if you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods. Let me read it this way, according to the New Covenant. Verse 20, if you forsake the Lord and serve money, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after he has done good to you. The people said to Joshua, "No, but we will serve the Lord." And Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen for yourselves the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." Verse 23, Joshua says, "Now therefore, put away your love of money, which is in your midst, and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." And the people said to Joshua, "We will serve the Lord our God, and we will obey his voice." If you look in the continuation of that story in the book of Judges, turn over the page to chapter 2, verse 10, you see that even though these people said that they would serve the Lord and forsake the other gods, Judges 2, verse 10, "All that generation also were gathered to their fathers, and there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord, nor yet the work which he had done for Israel." They knew Joshua. They knew about their history, but they didn't know the Lord. And they didn't, and they served other gods. And I wonder, what will be the future of CFC 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 50 years from now? It doesn't have to be like it was for the people of Israel. It doesn't have to be like it was for that generation, but we must remember what we have heard. The opposite of God is money. And that's a distinctive message I've heard in CFC. And money has a way of creeping in. The love of money has a way of creeping in. I see it in my own flesh. I see how easy it is to be drawn into that and to not see that distinctive mark between God and money. And it's creeping into Christendom more and more. And it could very easily creep into our churches if it hasn't already. We must fight it, dear brothers and sisters. We must individually fight it. And you see, if you go back to chapter 1, you see what it was like. How did this serving of other gods come in? How will the serving of money come in if it does? We see, first of all, in Judges chapter 1, verse 5, that they were fighting against this one king, the Perizzites, and the king of the Perizzites, his name was Adoni-Bezek in verse 5. Judges 1 verse 5. "And they found him and fought against him, and they defeated the Canaanites and the Perizzites. But Adoni-Bezek, verse 6, fled, and they pursued him and caught him, but they didn't kill him." They didn't deal radically with the love of money. They cut off his thumbs and his toes, big toes. That's all they did. And you go on to see that at the end of verse 7, they brought him without his thumbs and big toes to Jerusalem, and he lived there until he died. It started with a little losing of that radical attitude. And that's how it will be. A little compromise in the area of money. Just cut off the big toes, just cut off the thumbs, but let him live there in a corner in your heart or in our hearts. And that's how that little bit of backsliding comes in, a little bit of the love of money. You read further on in chapter 16, relatives who were not part of the Israelites, the relatives of Moses' father-in-law, the descendants of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, went up from the city of Palms with the sons of Judah to the wilderness of Judah, which is the south of Arad, and they went and lived with the people. Relatives have often come in and drawn people away from the church and away from the truth to compromise in some area. That's another way in which the devil will try to sway us, allowing us to be influenced by the love of our relatives. Jesus said, "You cannot be my disciple if you love your relatives." Goes on to say in verse 19, you see, you can read that whole chapter, how one after the other, they took possession of parts of the country, but not all of it. Verse 19, "The Lord was with Judah, and they took possession of the hill country, but they could not drive out the inhabitants of the valley because they had iron chariots." God saw these little areas of compromise, and little by little, these enemies were allowed to remain. Little by little, that love of money was allowed to remain. And then you see a sad story beginning in verse 27. The Manasseh did not take possession. Verse 29, Ephraim did not take possession. Zebulun, verse 30, did not drive out the inhabitants. Verse 31, Asher did not drive out the inhabitants. Verse 33, Naphtali did not drive out. And then even Dan in verse 34. I think of these families in God's people, these tribes that should have destroyed wherever they were settling. They should have destroyed all the inhabitants, but they did not. And that could easily be the testimony of us in a few years, dear brothers and sisters, if we don't take it radically. The opposite of God is money. But God is on our side to help us. The third thing I want to mention is the third thing, distinctive thing that I heard in CFC is that my destination is not heaven, but it's to be with Christ and like him forever. Romans chapter 8, verse 29. Those whom God foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. And that's why we read in verse 28, God is causing all things to work together for us. If you have faith, if you love God, if your only ambition in life is to love him, to those who love God, we read in verse 28, and who are called according to this purpose, to be like Jesus, God will work everything out for your good. Even if it doesn't look like it, God will cause everything to work out for good if your ambition is to love him and if this is your purpose in life, to be conformed into his image. And so I pictured it, if you'll turn with me to Revelation chapter 14, I pictured it like an invitation to a wedding. I'm sure you've all received invitations to a wedding, but there's one invitation to a wedding that, in an earthly wedding, that is the most important to me, and that's the one when I got married myself. That's the most important wedding invitation I ever received. I've been to many other weddings, but that's the one that mattered the most. And there's one wedding invitation that's most important for all of us, for each of you, dear brothers, dear sisters, dear children, dear young people. If you look at the wedding invitation that Jesus has given you, it's not just to come and eat the biryani and the brinjal curry and whatever else. It's to be his bride. He's invited you to live with him beginning now, to not just be sitting in the audience watching the marriage feast of the Lamb, but to be sitting at the table with Jesus. Because we read in Revelation chapter 14, verse 4, and this is the invitation that CFC showed me. Revelation 14, towards the end of verse 4, these are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These have been purchased from among men as first fruits to God and to the Lamb, and no lie, no hypocrisy was found in their mouth. They are blameless. So I thank God that he allowed me to be raised up in CFC, to grow up here, and over time to understand these truths and to experience them in increasing measure, little by little, even though it's taking me a long time. But I thank God for showing me that my destination, that my where I'm looking and where I'm headed is not just to sit there in the audience at the wedding feast of the Lamb, but to be sitting with Jesus as his bride. And I hope that we'll continue to hold on to these truths that we've heard, following the example of those who are following Christ, hating the money with all of our hearts, and fixing our eyes on being with Jesus wherever he goes. May the Lord bless us, bless you all, dear brothers and sisters. I wish I could have seen you all in person. I hope to be able to see you all in person sometime soon, God willing. Thank you.